Welcome back. The program is still AM Chat. We shift our focus now to our discussion. We're talking about the federal government's ministerial meeting, town hall meeting that was held in Lagos State. Of course, the issues behind the facts that were raised. You can be part of the program. Our Twitter handle is at MITV Lagos. Much later, the phone lines will be opened for you to contribute. Your views, your comments are well appreciated. In the meantime, we do have our guest in the studio with us. Yemi Daniels is still here, who is a social commentator and a political analyst. Thank you for still staying back. And of course, we have Mr. Victor Okai. Of course, he's from the creative industries, contributed so much, but now he's a political analyst and a social commentator. Good morning, Mr. Victor.
Good morning.
Good to have you.
The fear of Mr. Victor High from the APC is beginning that week now. You're welcome, Mr. Victor High.
Thank you very much.
Recently in Lagos, there was this well-packaged, well-organized town hall meeting. Ordinarily, I think it is called for because there must be some kind of communication breach between Nigerians and the government. There's been a lot of speculations, conclusions to issues, and Nigerians were not well educated. And these has, of course, created misinformed opinions. And I think for us, that was a good move. Okay, we saw the Minister of State for
Petroleum.
Lai Mohammed was there, the finance, and the media. You know, it was a well organized event, and of course, Fashola was trying to actually explain some of the challenges on power. I talked about vandalization, but first, Mr. Vizio Hai, do you see that gathering as a good initiative by the federal government? Let's start from there.
It was a charade. It was at best a glorified press conference. Talking about communication was just one way. I mean, if you wanted to do a town hall meeting, the true definition of a town hall meeting, it was not same stage managed. You should be able to throw it open and then allow people from the community to come out and speak and defend. There should be a proper exchange. You understand what I'm saying? This was just a press. It was just to generate media. That's all.
What do you mean stage managed? What do you mean just?
Did you see anybody with any strong voice? Was I there?
Maybe the strong voices did not attend.
Who did I get an invitation? Don't they have access to me?
Maybe they weren't following online.
Why should I follow anybody online? If they wanted me, they would have asked for me. There are lots of people who could have been able to speak for the masses, who would be able to ask the right questions. He used the word well-packaged. Not a well-packaged media event, you call it a town hall meeting. That's not what a town hall meeting is. A town hall meeting is engaging. People will tell you, you see, I will respect Babangida till tomorrow. This was a man who, I mean, he says it till tomorrow, that one of the people he respects the most is Gani Fawemi. Because Gani will tell him the truth as it is. Most leaders will never hear the truth from people around them. Because those ones always tell them, Rakesh, they all is well. Oga, don't mind those people, they're all telling lies and all that. Which is why you have an IGP saying don't buy fuel in Jerikam when you know clearly that there is no fuel. The man does not know because he doesn't buy fuel. He doesn't buy fuel for his car. He's never in darkness. So he doesn't know what you and I go through. That's why I can easily say don't sell fuel in Jerikams. You are in darkness, maybe you just get back to a new baby. Look at the terrible sun. The temperatures have risen to almost over 40-something, about 41 degrees. I'm going to it on a daily basis now. Between 38 and 41 degrees. So scorching hot. You just get back to a new baby. There is no light. You have perpetual darkness. Okay, you get a generator. You should power. There's no fuel to power it. And you want to go and buy fuel. And they say, don't buy in Jerican. Of course, you are living far from reality.
Okay, sorry, quickly, Mr. Daniels. Going back to that question, we just wanted to find out from you. Was it in the right direction? Because the argument is that Nigerians needed to get a feedback. Because if a government does not come out to talk, there's going to be a lot of misunderstanding and misconception.
Well, interestingly, if government wanted to talk, a press briefing was ideal. Now, targeting a town hall meeting actually messed up the entire thing. A town hall meeting is supposed to be like you're saying something and some other people are putting scrutinizing what is being said. That how do we trying to juxtapose what is being said from the reality on ground. What we didn't see at the town hall meeting was such a radical position. Now, we're not asking people, we're not saying that people shouldn't, government shouldn't come forward to say something. But people should be able to say, okay, given these things that you have said and this reality on ground, can we reconcile these things? And government will be able to say, okay, this is the position. We didn't get to see any of such things, unfortunately. The government, the ministerial group just came, each of the ministers just came to say a few things that what they have always wanted to tell people. And nobody put them to task on those things, honestly.
Mr. Victor, my question is, if there's a meeting, be it a press conference, be it a town hall meeting, do I compel people to talk? Now, you did say, okay, some people who would have spoken for Nigerians weren't given the privilege of attending, so to speak, but to an extent, I think some of these people did not follow. I wasn't there. I'd have loved to be there, but I didn't.
But let me ask you, you were in the media. Did you know that there was a town hall? Be honest, did you know?
As a media organization, we knew. We knew. That's why we attended. That's why we attended.
As a media organization. Fine. The question I'm asking is, when people
to come and cover, to do a coverage.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, this coverage.
It's okay.
Maybe.
They needed the press. They needed the media.
Maybe the publicity for this particular edition of the town hall meeting wasn't as massive as we expected.
Where did it hold?
Where did he hold? I have no idea.
Of course, he held there.
No, where?
I have no idea on the venue.
Okay, no idea. Okay, but fine. I mean, no, in the media, your house was invited. Your organization.
Of course, we have representatives.
No, I'm not arguing. I know, I'm not arguing. Even after you have brought it and they've shown you, where did it hold is what I want to know. I don't know where it held. It held in Lagos.
No, the bottom line is that it is not the issue of where it was held, Mr. Vito High. The basic issue is that we're going to be showing you clips of what was said.
Benjamin Peters said the issues behind the facts. Some of these ministers and politicians come to analyze the issues, most times we now see to bear that, okay, these people have challenges. These are the issues. But then there are facts that, okay, if there are facts that you have challenges. But the issues behind the facts are, there are challenges. How do you intend to manage and what do you intend to do? Even Katiku came out to explain what he intends to do with the Minister of Petroleum. And so many persons were like, oh my goodness, I didn't know this man was going through all of these challenges.
Diversion of petroleum products to neighboring countries.
May I speak to that issue?
I'm coming here. Fashola talked about the vandalization of the pipelines, and they're going to make sure that they tackle it. And of course, a number of other issues, but you want to react to.
I want to say to Fashola especially, good morning, sir. Why do I say so? When Jonathan was going through the same problem, the last administration, I remember Nebo called what was like a town hall meeting as well. Charlie Boy was there. They were explaining to Nigerians about vandalization, and Lai Mohammed and the rest of them were ridiculing them. They never took them seriously. I said good morning to them. They had just woken up to the facts that they were living in denial of. When the government was telling Nigerians the truth, they were using propaganda and the media against such issues. I do not have any pity for the government. You know why? Don't tell me about people taking things through the border. Why do I pay taxes? Why are you using my taxes to pay customs? What is the job of customs at the border? What is the job of security men at the border? That you use oil meant for Nigerians and it's going out and you're coming to give me excuses? Why did we hire you as a government?
Of course, this there's going to be trackers on the tanker.
Another avenue for waste of money. When there were security issues, didn't they talk about, including the last administration, didn't they talk about putting a CCTV? How did it help? I'm talking about the last administration.
Okay.
You forget all this so-called issue of trackers and the rest of them. What are you tracking? You're only tracking movement. It's tracking, checking the volume of fuel. I don't know if you get what I'm saying.
Of course,
I can come here, empty the same fuel into another tank at the next at a filling station, and that tank without a tracker can go to wherever it's going to.
Mr. Daniel, sir, the foreign minister was also there, and he talked about justifying the trips
by the president
that we needed to quickly cross the T's and dot the I's in terms of the foreign relationship with the foreign countries. One, this building up or oiling this relationship will attract foreign investors into the country. But basically, from what Mr. Victor said, what's the position?
You know, when, after that town hall meeting, when I heard about the things that was said, I came up with an allegory that Nigeria was like a woman that had been raped several times and who had children, who a particular man was also dating. And the man will go visit the woman, and on his way to the woman's house, some hoodlums will hold him by the road and take away everything he was taking to the woman. Meanwhile, there was this other person who wanted the same woman but didn't have the capacity, and kept envying that man who was dating the woman, because he also thought that there was still value in the woman. But he also knew those guys, they were always willing the man. And at some point in time, they had capacity to begin to date the woman. And somehow it struggled and it took the woman away from the first guy. Meanwhile, while the first guy was dating the woman, each time he met those guys at the club, he says, "Don't mind that guy, he's not a serious guy." And when it was his time, he was dating the woman. And those same guys would relay that man, and they would say to him, they would take everything he was taking to the woman. And he will still go to the woman empty-handed, like the first man would always say that, "I'm sorry, these were the people that stopped me from giving you the sins that I was bringing your way." What am I trying to say? Both parties face the same challenge. Like Mr. Ahai said, we see, if at the time that the president, the former administration, complained about certain sins, we all rallied around the government and we said, "Okay, let us deal with this issue once and for all. Let us find a way of collectively, as patriotic citizens." Unfortunately, our politicians are not patriotic. And that's why we are having the same problem. We are having all the problems that kept being recycled. Now, APC comes to tell us now, they're just making an excuse as far as I'm concerned, honestly. I'm giving this government till November. All the up to now, I'm still saying, okay, maybe. But November, I'd have been able to take a decision that nothing good can come out of this government. But to the best of my knowledge, all that has been said and that has been done so far is far from impressive, honestly.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, if our director, you just want to tell our producer to be on the standby, we'll take the track up sounds of the minister, Fashola Lai Mohammed,
on cue.
Please, we'd like you to just be on the standby. Now, Mr. Victor Hai, town hall meetings, basically, by virtue of our understanding, is always a forum to rub minds. And at the end of the day, tell ourselves the truth and look for solutions. It was an interactive session. The media also had the opportunity of asking questions.
Friendly media.
Yeah, but if we look at what is happening right now, don't you think that at least there's some sense of purpose by the government to try to see that some of these issues are resolved? Because if they had not said anything, you could have also complained again.
No. As far as I'm concerned, the only way to say something is to do something. You know? We've been telling our stories since May 29. It's stories that we've been hearing. Enough of the stories. Everything they've said, didn't they say by April 7th, the fuel crisis will be over? Stop telling us.
To be honest, Kachiku said, by May, Nigerians wanted to crucify him. He now said, okay, April 7th. This April is out right now.
I'm not arguing.
Okay.
Even if you give that to him and all that.
Yes.
Have you ever had it this bad? Even during the June 12th crisis and the subsequent anniversaries, did you ever have it so bad with fuel crisis? Did you ever have it so bad with power? Did you ever have it so bad with your economy? For how long? What we're talking about here, Nigeria is not the only one. If we're talking about the oil crisis going on, Venezuela is going through the same problem. They are not blaming past government. You understand what I'm saying? The other countries are all going through the same problem. We're making it seem like, 16 years ago, Venezuela is in crisis right now, but they're not blaming any past government.
Nobody is talking about past government. If the budget is signed.
They are facing things square.
If the budget is signed now, will we have problems? You know,
sorry, before you answer, sir. Yeah. Sorry. The issue of government. Who has majority in the National Assembly? I throw that to you.
Of course, the ruling party.
The ruling party. Who is in power? The ruling party. So what excuse do you have?
And so why the delay in the budget?
Yeah, it's all of this story. Stop telling us. Stop town hall meetings. Get to roll up your sleeves. Get into the debt and start working for Nigerians.
Okay, we would we'll just take.
Before we go for the sound bites,
the budget has been signed.
If the budget has been signed.
Of course, by now money will have been released. A lot of projects, of course. The Minister for Transport, what's his name?
Butimi Amaechi.
Amaechi, of course, also talked about the Calabar, Lagos rail. I wonder why that has become. But quickly, if the budget is signed, I think we could scale through.
Well, if the body, you talk about money here. Yeah. How do we finance that budget? You know, the government has been going everywhere looking for money to finance that budget, given the fact that oil is no longer as profitable as it used to be. So even if the budget were signed, we probably would have run into troubled waters now because the budget was ambitious. Remember, I did say that given the oil plunge, that the budget benchmark was about almost $40, and I asked the question, what was the rationale? But maybe it's working because the Minister of Finance did say that they relied on an expert advice that oil price was likely to go up a little bit, and then sharing news that the first with the World Bank came and said we're likely to have $41 at the end in the year 2016. But the question will be that is the $41 sustainable for the Nigerian budget? We're not sure. You understand? So even if the budget were passed now, the problem will be that how do we finance the budget?
Okay, so we'll take a short break now.
Yeah, with this, if our producer is...
They are claimed recovered funds. Today, 15 point something billion dollars, which is by far in excess of your budget.
Well, if you just join us...
Recovered?
Well, that's what they... I don't know whether recovered or still that they have discovered. Whether discovered or recovered. What is fact?
Yes, the papers have reported, but... The papers have reported.
Quoting who
the
now?
The papers have not specifically quoted which particular institution recovered this.
No, but Lai Mohammed gave us that information.
Lai Mohammed
or is it EFCC?
Not EFCC. Lai Mohammed gave us information, but there are several other organizations that came to counter.
Are you suggesting he's lying?
No, I'm not suggesting he's lying because I'm not.
Are you saying Lai Mohammed lying?
Don't allow Mr. Victor Okai to put you on the spot. Quickly now, if our producer is ready, in case you're joining us anyway, we're looking at the ministerial town hall meeting, the issues behind the facts. What you're about going to see or listen to, comments quickly, briefly, from three major ministers or so at the town hall meeting. Let's have it now.
Be achieved overnight.
The power issue sits in one world. There is not enough power. 5,000 megawatts for 170 million people is just not enough. The solution is delivering more power on an incremental and sustained basis. And during the Q&A, I will share with you all of the detailed plans that we are making in that respect. And the results that are manifested and the results that we can see from them.
The next one was awarded by President Goodluck Jonathan. That is from Lagos to Calabar. In all these, there are agreements the Chinese government that will have capital funding of 15%. We did not fulfill this agreement. The only place behind this was the Kaduna Abuja, which is yet to be completed. And we're working extremely hard to ensure that between June and July, we will come at life that way and we can start work. At the end of the day, what are all the achievements? First is that for the first time, the average loss position of energy was averaging about 2,300 billion as we know, has reduced substantially. As of January this year, it was down to about 3 billion. Second is that the GSDP for this very opening program, which we will be has made a series of $1 billion over $1 billion over the period of $1,000, and that is a massive savings. The third is that the payment on subsidies, which last year alone was in excess of $1 trillion, has been reduced to near zero.
Employment of 500,000 unemployed members who will be safe and employed as teachers and employed by primary schools. The second is the employment of 370,000 non-graduates, artisans, and technicians who will also be trained and employed. The third is the program targeting 1 million people, farmers, market investors, etc., who will be granted loans to set up small businesses. The first is the cash transfer to the most vulnerable Nigerians, not the sir.
Okay, this is just possibly in the subsequent broadcast we'll try to bring you more details of that presentation. Mr. Yemi Daniels, what's your comment?
Honestly, I want to ask, if I were at that town hall meeting, I would have asked the Minister of Petroleum that how were they able to bring down the subsidy to the man, to the level they brought it, as though it was some magic thing. For crying out loud, oil prices are dropped. So naturally, subsidy will drop.
Will disappear, because you're not subsidizing anything.
So those are the issues I would have raised at the time. I mean, that shouldn't be, more or less, that shouldn't be an achievement, if you ask me, that because oil prices plunged, naturally, the subsidies will reduce or possibly disappear.
Okay, we have a caller. Let's take this call. Hello, good morning. Good morning. What's your name and where are you calling from?
Good morning. Am I on the MITV?
Yes, you're live on MITV. What's your name and where are you calling from, please?
Can I talk to you?
Yes.
Go ahead.
You can.
Yes, my name is Mr. Adela.
Okay.
What I see in all this is, we are just, because it's amazing over there. Adela and Aleti, they are thinking of getting the number. When the president was there. When the number was there, the average Nigerian went to start here. I mean, two foods from Nigeria. Now, for the past 1 year, there's no business in the United States of America. We are all stranded. No money has changed, no electricity. No food roads, and the people tell no stories. And again, I will keep on listening to their nonsense. If you don't say, I think enough of it, their nonsense. Let them do the job, let them do the job, they will put to the $1 for $1. Let them do it now. They say the show will be $40. So, Elisa, let them do it now. Enough of it, their decision.
Lai Mohammed is just a person, an elderly person like Lai Mohammed. Tell lies. I don't know what.
Okay, thank you very much.
Even as much as you're trying to put a call across to us, try to be civil with your comments, please. Okay. No swear words, no insulting words. Try to be as civil as possible as you can be. Right. And very quickly, while we watch the broadcast, Doug Dorma actually talked about 5,000 that would be allocated to the poorest and vulnerable. Yes, that was part of the campaign promises of this administration. And they are very passionate and they're happy that they are reiterating that they're going to stick by it, 5,000 naira for the poor and vulnerable, and they see that as a big achievement. Let me come to Mr. Victor Kai. What are your comments on that? They keep reiterating on the 5,000 naira for the poor and vulnerable. Once the budget is passed, that would come on.
In the first place, when that promise was made, I found it insulting. And then later on, they denied it, and the president said that was not his priority. Now they have been forced to go back to it, and now they are shoving it in our face like something big, like a big deal, that we should be thanking God for, that they will be giving us, the poor people of this world, of this country, 5,000. Of course, we know that the 5,000, the list that they are drawing, we don't know what the parameter is, but obviously it's to service party members. Okay? To reward party members or loyalists.
But they haven't said.
What did they haven't said? Do you know the criteria? Has anybody come to your place to find out what the poor people are in your place? Have you met anybody who has asked questions about poor people?
Okay, we have
you
caller.
Got a call from your village, Mr. Victor, about the poor people there?
We have a caller. Hi. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, morning. What's the name and where are you calling from? Okay, thank you very much for joining us. Chief, go ahead. Okay.
I want to learn from one of this.
Okay, Mr. Victor Kai. His Twitter handle is Mr. Victor Kai.
Yeah. Can you call back after the program?
Victor Kai. Okay, Victor on the spot Kai.
Hello? Okay, we lost that. I think we just wanted to know you. So just do call. But basically, yeah, we want you to make your contribution. We have another caller. Good morning. Morning to you. Good morning.
Hello.
Hello, we can hear you. Go ahead. Okay, Mr. Tijani, kindly speak louder. Thank you. Okay. Thank you for your. We must be very civil here when you make your comments, because this is a TV station, and interestingly, in as much as you needed to express or whatever, but I think there's been some kind of balancing. We now know it's not just all for, but I think we also have for against.
But again, you must also mention that you invited the APC chairman.
Of course.
You haven't told the audience.
No, of course. So quickly, Mr. Daniels, if you look at the issues, because we said the issues behind the facts. In that soundbite there, of course, by the time we listened to a more detailed conversation during the question and answer session with Fashola, he talked about the vandalization issue.
The pipelines
have been vandalized, but he's saying that the federal government is determined and assuring Nigerians that they are going to do something about it. Apart from the there's also going to be tracking of putting track on all the pipelines and all that, investing so much. But they is promising that the 10,000 megawatts by 2019 will be a reality.
Well, I want to ask, the question I want to ask is, and that was why I had my issues against the APC government even before the elections. I was asking the question, how do they intend doing all the things that they said they were going to do? Now, could it be that Fashola did not know there were pipeline vandals before he became a minister? Didn't they factor all of those things? And that's my pain personally, that 1 year down the line, you're now beginning to tell us that vandals were inhibiting your productivity as a governor. Recall that in 2014, Fashola did say that any government that could not provide power in 6 months does not deserve to be a government. And that it wasn't, generating power was not rocket science. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
Now, 1 year down the line, he became minister barely about 6 or 7 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
Head or tail, it's way beyond 6 months since he became the minister. And I would have expected that before he took up the salt, like he did in Lagos State, that he had a document before he became governor. He would have had a document as soon as he was nominated, and that this was what he was coming to achieve, and this was the way he was going to achieve it. And while he was addressing people when he became minister, I didn't remember him talking about vandals at that press conference. And could it be that the governor wasn't the former governor was not well prepared for this responsibility?
Mr. Henry Daniels, do we have a caller? But you know, as the days go by, some of these issues begin to unfold. A few persons, I mean, like Mohammed would have said in the past, that when they got into power, they began to see the realities in governance. Okay, we have a caller.
Hello. Hello, good morning. Okay, we lost that call.
Okay, Lai Mohammed previously would say when they got into power, they began to see the realities on ground. He would say you cannot hit a wet, I'm trying to be very accurate, you can't hit a wet ground running. So many persons would say hit the ground running, let's see what you can do. He would say you can't hit a wet ground running. This
but the problem is you hit the ground running, now they are defining what kind of ground. The next day they say you can't hit a ground with broken bottles running. They will start giving excuses. You see, with how do I put it? Apologies to the man who called and said I was always criticized. I want to ask him, and I'm going to answer the question directly now. But you see, If, let me use myself as an example, if I deceive myself, I'm a fool. I mean, if I deceive you, I'm a fool. But if I deceive myself, I'm a bigger fool. So, as I sit down today as a Nigerian, even if I am there supporting the government, claiming all is well, my pocket will never deceive me. When I go to the market, it won't deceive me. At night, when I flick on my switch, it doesn't deceive me.
You were actually also against Jonathan when he didn't do well.
Exactly. You know, people just sit down there, they assume that people... but coming to talk about this issue of hit the ground running pipeline and the rest of them, you know something? In management or in accounting, you talk about cost-benefit or economics, cost-benefit analysis. You look at the cost, you look at the benefit. If the benefit outweighs the cost, then you go ahead. When the last government decided, okay, who are the people who are most likely able to safeguard and secure this thing for us? Because the way it's going, nothing is coming out of it. They say, okay, let's take a fraction of this money. No wahala. We'll go employ these militants as we got. They probably looked at it then as if it was empowering. Okay, even if. But did it stop it? Of course it did. Everything stopped and all of that. And then in the Southwest here, he got OPC. He didn't bring his job people to come to the Southwest. He got OPC because they were the ones on ground. Paid them and they were looking after these things. And there was peace. And everything was moved. You come suddenly, you just, without studying what it is, you scatter it and all that. Of course you will live with it. You understand what I'm saying? I'm not necessarily saying that must we pay people so that they will stop. But you see, there are short-term solutions, medium-term solutions, and long-term. So while you are planning, whether you are tracking, and in any case, we have satellites. What are we using? Even Google Earth. You know, come ahead.
Okay, we have a caller. Hello, good morning. Hello, yeah, go ahead. What's your name? Okay, go ahead, please. Okay, let me borrow that word, sabotage. Ms. Yemi Daniels, in as much as this present government, we could see some level of sincerity and purpose in trying to make sure that a lot of things are taken care of. But if you look at the entire ministerial the town hall meeting recently held, I just want to borrow that word. A sabotage. Do you think this government is being sabotaged by some people who just don't want things to work? Because if you look at the credibility of the president, you will know this is a man that has good intention. And there's always ways of wanting to make a government fail. So,
you know, I did say somewhere yesterday that I think the APC government underrated our challenges and overrated themselves.
Is that?
Yes. Now, in every system, there will only be saboteurs who benefit from a rot. Okay. Now, in planning your ideas, in implementing your idea, you must have factored all of those booby traps that you are likely going to
experience.
That was why I use the word. I have concluded that up until now, what I have seen is that they underrated our challenges and overrated themselves. They did not put certain things into consideration while they were making all the promises that they made. I'm not a fan of, because They should do things in the first year. But we should be able, the morning shows the day. We should be able to have an idea that this is where this government is going. Okay. 1 year down the line, there is no economic policy. You understand? 1 year down the line, not a single promise has been fulfilled. 1 year down the line, not a single conviction has been secured. You understand? We kept mounting anti-corruption and what have you. One of the biggest problems I have with this government, for instance, is that the present judicial system does not support anti-corruption. And for you to do anti-corruption, the judiciary must be fully integrated. And to that extent, there is need for some administrative reforms that can ride on the strength of the Administration of Criminal Justice Act signed in 2015. And that would have given, I said something, that the last administration provided a platform for this government to ride on, but vendetta decimated those chances. Because, for instance, the administration, what is being used against Saraki, for instance, is what we had in ACJA 2015. The ACJA 2015 postulates that you cannot stop a trial, substantial trial, because of an injunction. The both cases will run pari passu. Paraventure, the injunction right, then you stand down the trial. Now, if that was not there, Saraki would have been off the hook now. So all that is needed in the circumstance is to leverage the last administration. And I said it, I kept telling a few friends that I am not for APC or PDP, honestly, I did not vote. I didn't vote at the last election because for me, both guys were no-nos. I thought Nigerians had more intelligent people to do the job. Now, to that I said, let us benchmark the performances of the last administration so that we will know how to at least call the next administration. Kemi Falana came on TV, I think 2 weeks ago, that there is nothing new about this government. That for crying out loud, the Lagos-Calabar Railroad was a Jonathan administration, was Jonathan's project. The same thing with the Abuja-Kaduna Rail Lines. That this government just wants to come and spend money there and take the glory. And for him, nothing is being done as far as that is concerned. I think such are people that privy some other information. So the bottom line is this.
It's not a question of sabotage.
No, it's not. No, you should have factored all of those things into the governance.
Okay, another major subject that was discussed at the town hall meeting was the president's several foreign trips, and they were particularly about the trip to China. They were talking about the yuan, that it's a good thing that the president has come up with this initiative to douse tension on the dollar. For you, that has also been making the headlines, it's been making rounds of papers, and of course the APC administration sees it as a big achievement. It hasn't, I wouldn't say an achievement yet, but it's a step in the right direction for them. We haven't achieved that yet, but we're in the process. Do you see anything different, doing business with China, dousing tension on the dollar, using the yuan?
I think it's a stroke of genius as a short-term measure to ease the pressure on the dollar.
Okay.
You know, that's going the way of the yuan. But on the other hand, we also need to be very careful. Not every victory. In planning strategy, you must look at the overall goal and objective in deciding. Sometimes you may fail or give up some things in order to attain your overall objective. Small victories along the way may give you temporary relief, but ultimately, will it take you to where you're going to? Now let me go to where I'm going to. America declares war or causes it an act of war when you do anything against their economic interests. That is definition of act of war for America, for the United States of America. It is also common knowledge that the foreign reserve of China is warehoused in dollars, not in yuan. Whereas this is very good, but throwing it in the face of America, whom even the British, the Europeans, all of them fear, and they look at my times, permit me to speak in Pidgin, and they say, wait till this America's. But it's not for nothing. I listened to John Major 2 nights ago, he was talking when Obama was talking about the Brexit issue. These guys fear America. I don't know why. But if they fear them, and me, I fear those ones, then there must be something about them. Now, remember that the reason that your oil is the way it is today is because America turned its back on you.
Yeah.
If they turn their back even more, I feel sorry for us. What we're celebrating now We can do it and still be betting them. Don't throw it in their face. If those guys want to ruin your economy one day or upturn your government, it can happen just like
that. Mr. Victor, you think the PDP administration, so to speak, would have done anything differently in terms of the economic policy?
How?
Yemi Daniels did say up until now, we do not really have a clear-cut direction on what the economic policies are. Although the APC stalwarts would counter that, with Maro, several policies that we put that they are trying to put in place and that would be put in place. But the average Nigerian on the street, of course, as he said,
I'll put it this way. PDP,
there is no economic policy.
PDP had, the government had a roadmap, the last administration. They had an economic team. You could clearly see that they were responsive. Which was why they were able to grow the GDP to become the largest in Africa. They were able to save, if not for people like Amechi and some of the governors who were saying, what are you saving for? Spend the money, which now nobody's holding them accountable for. We would have strategic reserve by now see us through a time like this.
Thank you very much, Mr. Victor High and Mr. Daniel. Thank you very much. Well, that's it. That's all we can take.